So, in all, formally to begin the lecture, today's lecture is about various research methods, and I have titled it as various research methods and introduction. Let me begin by the very first question. I may be speaking about lots of basics. Some of you may think that these are very basics, but based on my experience, you know, interacting with students, interacting with research students across the country in different universities, I had figured out that there are lots of confusion even about the basics of research. So I would be spending some time even on the basics of research. And for the benefit of the participants, I have a PPT which I am going to share now. Yes, this is the PPT which just a minute. Just one second. These are tricky. Just you may have to wait for a minute. I don't think it's working. Just one second. Just one minute. Ek bar aa jana bahut. So I'm just trying to begin. In the meantime, I will just try to short out this screen sharing thing. I will focus on first what is research, why do we do research, and then move on to, you know, what is research question, what is an hypothesis, and then move on to what are the various research questions. Ye kaam nahi kar raha hai. ये वाला होगा, इसको बड़ा कर दे, स्क्रीन बड़ा कर दे, ठीक से आ गया. यस, सो फर्स्ट लेट मी say what is research. So the word research applies to any form of systematic and organized investigation of facts or collection of data. Remember, there are few words which have been highlighted, and I have highlighted that because it is important to figure out what is research. In a research, it is important to have systematic and organized investigation. Normally, if you tell someone that you are doing research in social sciences, and the kind of research or the kind of topic on which I do research mostly on, say, elections in India, voting behavior, people have the tendency to say, you know, what is there to do research in social sciences? I know most of the things which you would come up based on your research. But what distinguishes, what differentiates research with, you know, a general understanding, general perception is systematic and organized investigation. So it is important to, in any research, it is important to have a systematic and organized investigation of facts or collection of data. Data collection is important in research, and when we collect the data, it is analyzed, it is also analyzed. And what is important to do is to the data collection and the analysis of the data which has been collected must be systematic. So it is very important, this word is very important, this term is very important. It has to be kept in mind that in the research, when the researcher collects the data, it cannot be haphazard. It has to be a systematic collection of data and organized investigation. Some method, a method must be used for collection of data and analysis of data. Now, basic question, very, very basic question. Why do we do research? It is usually done to find an answer. If we don't have any questions in our mind, we cannot do research. So normally it is done to find an answer to a question. So the connected issue is that it is important to have a question in your mind if you want to do research. If you don't have a question in your mind, you can't do research, or you should not be doing research, because research is meant to find answers to questions. If you don't have any questions, why do you want to do research? You might say, I want to do research because I want to get a higher degree. That's all right. But technically, theoretically, practically, I think for every researcher, even if you want to just get a degree, you must have a question. If you don't have a research question, you can't do research. We do research to collect information about something. And what is that something? That something is your research question. So we do research in order to find answers to some question. We do research to collect information about that question. Researchers do research, or we want to do research to investigate or to know about something. One cannot do research if we don't want to know anything. And this is what I am trying to stress. If we don't want to, if we have no curiosity, if we don't want to understand, if we don't want to know anything, then we cannot do research. There is a need to have a question before someone even thinks of doing a research. So these are basically the points to stress. Why someone should do research, or why someone do research? So there is a need to have a question before someone even thinks of doing a research. So it is very important to have a, based on all the discussion which we had on this slide, the one point is very clear, that you need to have a question. It is important to have a question. If you don't have a question, you cannot do research, or you should not be doing research if you don't have any question in your mind. Now, what is the stage of doing research? How do we begin our research? Normally, you would say, you know, I fill a form, I apply to the university, etc., etc. But even before that, whenever we try and develop a research proposal, we need to have a research topic. And it becomes very crucial. That's very crucial, the topic which you select, because that is the starting point of your research. If you select a wrong topic, then you end up, you end up doing research on the topic on which you never wanted to do research. So selecting a topic is very, very important. How should one select a topic? And I would also like to, based on my own experience, mention how the topic is being selected these days in various universities. Normally, when I come across research students in different universities, people tell me, if I ask a question, so how did you select your topic? Why are you doing research on topic A, B, or C? And the normal response would be, normally the supervisor has asked me to do a research on this topic. So the personal interest on a particular topic is very low while selecting a research topic. large number of researchers are selecting topic based on the advice of your supervisor, your friend, etc., etc. So that is, I think, how large number of researchers, I'm not saying that everyone is selecting the topic based on the advice of the supervisor, or supervisor has given you a topic to do research, but there are lots and lots of instances where research topic is being selected not based on your personal interest, but largely because, you know, your supervisor want you to do research on topic A, B or C. So these are the basic points of selecting research topic. How do you select research topic? Consider your personal interest in the topic. That's very important. You must have a personal interest in the topic on which you want to do research. If you don't have interest in the topic, I don't think you should be even making an attempt to do research on that topic. Evaluate the importance of the topic on which you want to do research. Yes, interest component is important. You must have interest in the topic. Also, give some time. Think carefully whether this topic is important for doing research. So do give a thought whether the topic on which you want to do research is important. Is important or not. Assess if the topic is relevant and timely. It is also important to figure out if the topic on which you want to do research has some relevance. Is it timely? If somebody was doing a research on farmers' distress, rural unrest, this is very topical these days. It's not only in the light of what is happening on the borders of Delhi. It's not only about the farmers' agitation at the moment, but in the country, at least for the last few years, we have been hearing, reading, talking about rural distress, rural livelihood issues in the rural India. So if somebody is doing a research on that topic, it is very relevant and timely. Judge if the time available for doing research is sufficient. It is very important. One should not be selecting a topic without even giving a thought that, you know, how much time do you have for doing your research? Do you have sufficient time to do the research? That's very important while selecting the topic. Weigh the level of difficulty in doing research on that topic. It is also important to figure out, is it difficult? Is it extremely difficult? Because the topic should be doable. You should not select a topic on which it becomes very, very difficult to collect the data and do research. So that's also very important, that weigh the level of difficulty in doing research on that topic. Finally, assess the possible expenses on pursuing research on that topic. You may be required to do field work. You may be required to do maybe ethnographic field work. You may be required to do a survey. You may be doing a case study. And whichever method you apply, there would be degree of difference, but there are possible expenses on pursuing research on any topic, whichever topic you select. So do give a thought, do make an assessment of all these things. How much time you have? Is your topic relevant? Is your topic timely? What is the level of difficulty of collecting the data on this? And what are the possible expenses? So it is very important, research topic, because once you select the topic, once it is approved by the committee, and I know that in various universities, it is not easy, it is almost impossible to change your topic. So if you select a topic on which you start facing these kinds of difficulty, the difficulty of collecting data, difficulty of, you know, expenses, it has become very expensive. Suppose you had suggested a topic of Indo-US relationship and you had mentioned in your research proposal that you will do a field work and possibly you need to travel to US to do field work. If that is what was mentioned in your proposal, now you have to go to travel, you have to travel to US to do field work. It becomes very expensive. So all these judgment needs to be made by the researcher while you are selecting your research topic. One has to be very, very careful about researching, about selecting research topic. The current difficulty, I think the difficulty at the moment is researchers don't spend adequate time, don't discuss or don't give a careful thought about the topic on which they want to do research. Now, what are the parameters of judging a research topic? More or less, maybe some repetition from the previous slide, but it is important because since it is very important that you must select a research topic which has some practical value in about the topic, you should have some interest. So that is why some more thought on that. Does it have a practical value? It must be very clear. Does it have a practical value? All topic may not have a practical value, but still practical value in terms of in respect of the stream in which you want to do research. People doing research in economics, people doing research in political science, people doing research in literature, practical value would be of a different kind. People doing research in economics, the practical value may be some kind of an input in policy making, but somebody doing research in literature, Hindi, Sanskrit, English, it may not have that kind of a practical value of giving an input to policy making, but still it has a practical value in terms of building a body of knowledge. So it is very important to figure out what practical value your research is going, your research has. Will your research fill the gap in the body of knowledge on the topic? Is there a gap? Is there some gap about the topic on which you are doing research or on which you want to do research? And will the topic on which you are doing research fill the gap in the body of knowledge? Can your research be compared with other research or more or less similar topic? A good research is also judged by replicability. If you do a research, if you take up a model which cannot be replicated, it cannot be replicated by other researcher, then it is not considered as a good topic. So when you do research, it is also important that to figure out whether the topic on which you are doing research is compared, can be contrasted with other research topic. And will your research address the contradictions or findings published on research on similar topic? So it is also important to figure out if your research, the kind of research which you are doing, the topic which you have selected for your research, will add to the body of knowledge, whether it is going to contradict already the findings which has been published on similar piece of research done by some other scholar, or whether it is going to substantiate. It is not necessary that it should always contradict. It is also possible that it may supplement, it may reinforce the findings which has been shared by some other researcher on similar topic. So these are the parameters to judge a good research topic. So now, stages of research. What are the various stages of research? Research question. We have moved from research topic. Now the topic is, I'm saying hypothetically, now we are through with your research topic. You are a researcher based on all the considerations which we discussed, like in the last 10-15 minutes, that when you are thinking about selecting your research question, you have to be careful about these things. Now you have given a thought, you have assessed your research topic. So now the topic is finalized. So we are moving from topic to research question. Topic is broader. It's a very broad thing. And research question becomes very, very specific within your research topic. So we have moved, the researcher has to move on from research topic to now research question. So posing a problem. You must have a research question. If you want to do research, you must have a research question, and research question should always end with question mark. There could be some exceptions. We can talk about this when we have time for discussion. There could be some topics in which you may think that in the literature or in some other field, I really don't have a research question, the kind of research question people can have in sociology, history, political science, economics, or in education, or in some other social sciences field. But generally, in a research, once you select the research topic, we move down, we move ahead, and after research topic, we have to think of a researcher needs to think of a research question. So you have to think of a research question which you want to investigate in your research, whether you're doing your MPhil or you're doing your PhD. Research question should always end with a question mark. It is not a statement, it is a question. And I have figured out that there are lots of confusion about what is a research question and what is an hypothesis. I will give some examples to clarify what is the difference between a research question and a hypothesis. But generally, I have figured out that there is some confusion. I don't think I should hesitate to say there is a lot of confusion about research question and hypothesis. What do we do in research? Do we test hypothesis? Do we try to prove hypothesis? So, in the course of my discussion with you, I will also try and clarify what is a research question, what is a hypothesis, what a researcher tries to do when he or she does research, whether he or she proves the hypothesis, tries to prove hypothesis, test hypothesis, etc. So, what is a hypothesis? Hypothesis is a specific statement. It's a statement of prediction. It is an explanation of observable facts or phenomena that may be verifiable, tested through investigation that can be reproduced. So, after the research topic, you need to select a research question. And once you have a research question, then that is followed by a hypothesis. A research question always ends with a question mark. Hypothesis never ends with a question mark. It is a specific statement of prediction. You have a question and you predict what may be the answer to that question. And then when we do research, when a researcher does research, we try to test the hypothesis by collecting data, doing the analysis. So it is an explanation of observable facts. How does a researcher think about hypothesis, the specific statement? Based on observable facts or phenomena, what is happening across. Like if I take the example of there is farm distress in India. Is there a farm distress in India? Question mark. This is a research question. Hypothesis. Yes, farmers are in a bad shape. Farming does not give adequate return. So this is kind of an hypothesis. How did I develop this hypothesis? Based on observable facts, phenomena. This is what I keep hearing. This is what I keep observing. So based on that, my hypothesis is, the research question is farming in India in a bad shape? Are farmers in a bad shape? Is farming in India in a bad shape? That's a research question. Hypothesis, yes, farmers are in a bad shape. Farming does not give you adequate, returns. So this is kind of an hypothesis. And how did I develop that hypothesis, or how did the researcher develop that hypothesis? Based on explanation of observable facts, phenomena, based on what is happening, why farmers are protesting. Not only why farmers are protesting, you might say these are only small number of farmers, but even by reading in the newspaper, reading the literature, looking at what is happening in the country. So based on that, I have a hypothesis that yes, farming is in a bad shape in India at the moment. These are examples I'm taking. You may have agreement, disagreement with that, but I need to take some examples to explain. While it is desirable to have a hypothesis, but it is not essential, as I said earlier. There may be some topics, some streams in which you may not have a research question, you may not have a hypothesis. But normally it is desirable to have a it is essential, almost essential, to have a research question, and like you must have a hypothesis. Now to give you another example, research question: did Balakot airstrike help BJP in gaining popular support? This is what happened just before 2019 Lok Sabha elections. So if people, if this could be a research question, a researcher can pick up this research question, and what could be the hypothesis? Balakot airstrike helped the BJP in gaining popular support. So if that is the research question, this is the hypothesis, and then the researcher will collect data. How will he collect data? Remember, I mentioned earlier, the researcher will collect data systematically. He or she will analyze the data systematically using a method, and then this hypothesis will be tested, whether really Balakot airstrike helped BJP in gaining popular support or not. So that's the further step in doing research. Just to explain further, maybe a few more questions to explain. Research question: did Muslim women vote for BJP in 2019 Lok Sabha election? Most of my examples are from, you know, voting behavior, election studies, because this is my core area of research. But you could think of various other kinds of research questions. So this is another research question: Do we witness a shift among Muslim women in favor of BJP in 2019 Lok Sabha elections? The same research question can be put differently. Was there a shift among Muslim women towards BJP in 2019 Lok Sabha elections? Hypothesis: yes, more Muslim women voted for BJP in 2019 compared to 2014. So this is an hypothesis. One more question, and this is from the recent one: was women vote crucial for the victory of NDA in Bihar assembly election 2020? Hypothesis: women voted for NDA in very large numbers. It was important for NDA's victory in Bihar. What was common in all the three or four examples which I mentioned? The common thing was all the research questions ended with a question mark. If you recollect, all the three research questions ended with a question mark, and all the hypotheses were a statement. And a researcher, when the researcher do research, he or she tries to test this hypothesis. So that was common, and in order to stress this point, that research questions always end with a question mark, I used these three examples to explain, to stress this point again and again, that research question is very important in research. Whenever a researcher is formulating a research question, the question must end with a question mark. And normally a research question is followed by a hypothesis. And hypothesis never ends with a question mark. It always ends with a full stop. It is a statement. It is a statement based on observable facts. It is not a statement based on the data which you have collected, the research which you have done. The research or the data collection will follow after your hypothesis. After you are clear about your research question, you are clear about your hypothesis, and then by way of doing research, you need to test your hypothesis. And in order to do that, the researcher moves ahead. You collect data, you do the analysis, and that is what is all about research. But even before that, so we have moved from step one, which is deciding a research topic. Second step: once you have a research topic, title of your research, researcher needs to have a research question. Once you have finalized your research question, you should have a hypothesis. Once you have a hypothesis, so this much is now your structure is clear, that this is what you want to do. What do you do next? Do you immediately plunge into collecting data and doing the analysis? No, I don't think so. And this is also a mistake normally researchers make. You need to do literature review. Normally what is happening that we tend to forget about literature review. Normally this is seen as kind of an add-on thing, and normally researcher think that, you know, there is no need to spend time on literature review. Literature review normally is being done only when you reach the stage of writing your thesis, because that's a mandatory requirement. It should be, there should be 4 or 5 pages of literature review in your thesis. So normally I've seen people doing literature review at the end of, once you have done everything, you have collected the data, you have done the analysis, you have even written your most part of your thesis, and then later on you realize that, oh, there is a need to also have few pages of literature review, and then you add, you know, few pages of literature review. That's not what is desirable. That's not what is expected from a researcher. It is important to do literature review once you have finalized your research question, once you have developed your hypothesis. I think this is the time to do a literature review. A literature review is very, very important. If you don't do literature review, proper literature review, you can land yourself in some kind of a trouble. As I said, normally people are not doing literature review when it should be done. It should be done immediately after you have finalized your research question, you have finalized your hypothesis. But normally people do only at the time of writing your thesis. And I will give you an example to explain why it is important to do literature review before you start the data collection. Just to give you a practical example, suppose I want to travel to Shimla at the moment. Sunday I want to travel to Shimla. I should actually check the weather condition there. I should check what is the temperature, because that's essential. It is very important for me to do the literature review of Shimla. How I should travel, what is the temperature, because that will help me in packing my luggage. Because then I need to know, what kind of woolens I should be carrying with me. If I have not done the literature review, if I don't do this little bit of collecting information about what is the temperature in Shimla, etc., and I just land there, I may find myself in a deep trouble. Maybe the temperature may be, it's freezing in Shimla, I'm not carrying adequate woolens. So what will happen? I'm not saying that I won't be able to survive there, I may be able to survive, but what might happen is I may need to buy some woolens there. I may be having woolens at my home, but once I have reached Shimla, I may need to buy some woolens. That is what is happening even in the research also. What is happening is that you don't do research, you don't do literature review, and at the time of writing your thesis, you do the literature review, and we just add these few pages in our thesis. That is not the right way. As I said, giving the example of travel, if I have to travel to Shimla, I need to check everything. Hotel is available, what is the temperature, how should I travel, and if I don't do collect this much of information before traveling to Shimla, I will land myself in a trouble. That is what researchers also do. Normally researchers land themselves in a trouble if you don't do proper literature review before you start collecting the data. As I said, I'm not saying you cannot then move ahead. Yes, if I have landed in Shimla without having proper woolens, I can buy there, but it's a waste of money, it's a waste of time. I could have used that money for something else, I could have used that time for something else. Similarly, if a proper literature review was done before the data collection was done, maybe the data collection, you could have decided about the model of data collection based on the literature review, you could have figured out that the data is already available. Somebody has already collected the data, so you could have done that. So the literature review is very important, and it should be done before the data collection starts. And why literature review? To prove that there has not been much work done on the topic on which you intend to do research, to prove that there are gaps in knowledge on the topic on which research is proposed, to demonstrate that your research will fill the gap, add to the knowledge and understanding on that topic, also to demonstrate that you have read extensively on the topic on which you are doing research. It's very important to collect information. It is very important to collect information on the subject on which you are, on the topic, on the subject on which you are doing research. Also, you are capable of critiquing others' work on that topic. So, literature review, these are the important points for why we should be doing literature review. How does literature review help in doing research? Normally, it helps in narrowing down research topic, helps in sharpening your research question. The example which I gave, if I had checked the temperature of Shimla before traveling to Shimla, I would have known what kind of woolens I should be carrying. So if a researcher has already done a review of literature, it can help him or her in narrowing down the research topic, help in sharpening the research question. It helps in probing questions which may not have been investigated earlier. So it can also help the researcher in sharpening the research question. It also helps in building a knowledge base for other scholar who wish to do research on similar topic or more or less similar topic. So these are the utilities of doing literature review even before you start collecting the data. Remember, I am stressing the point, literature review should be done before you begin to collect the data, because it will be very, very helpful for you, for a researcher, in sharpening your research question, in helping you to guide what kind of data you should be selecting. It should not be done after you have collected the data, after you have done the analysis. It should not be done at the last minute. It should not be done at the stage of writing the thesis. As I said, interacting with scholars in different universities, I have figured out that this is not taken seriously by most researchers. Literature review is not taken seriously. People do research literature review only as a fill in the gap, because in the thesis there are sections, and it is a technical requirement that there must be few pages of literature review to demonstrate that you have read the work on that topic. So people, researchers, normally do literature review only at the end, once they are in the stage of writing the report, writing their research thesis, and then most of the researchers, or many researchers, tend to do literature review at that time. It's not useful. It can only help you in fulfilling the technical requirement. But if the researcher does the literature review well before data collection, it can help the researcher in many, many ways. So please remember, spend some time in doing literature review before the data collection work starts. Now literature review has been done. Again, to recap, the title of your research is finalized. You have finalized your research question. You have developed a hypothesis. You have done your research. You have done your literature review. As I said, there is no shortcut. Don't jump. Follow this sequence. If you don't follow the sequence, you will land yourself in a trouble. Now you have done, you have passed all the three stages. This is the stage of thinking of research method. Which method should you select for your research data collection for your research. While we will spend time tomorrow basically to figure out how do you figure out which method to select. But today I will flag off various research methods and what are the strengths and weaknesses of various research methods. And tomorrow's research, tomorrow's lecture will follow from wherever we are going to leave today. So first, various research methods. So all research, there are various kinds of research methods. Broadly, we can divide the research methods into two types. I'm sure most of you or all of you would know that there are two broad categories of research: qualitative research method and quantitative research method. So these are the broad divisions. And first, one has to figure out whether you want to do qualitative research or you want to pick up a quantitative method. As I said, you have to decide. Doesn't mean that you should decide well in advance. It must be decided by giving a careful thought whether you want to use a qualitative method or a quantitative method. We will have discussions on that tomorrow, but let me flag what are the various methods within the qualitative method and what could be various methods of research within quantitative method. So let me first pick up the qualitative methods of research. What are the various qualitative methods of research? Remember, I am not saying these are the only five or six kind types of qualitative method. I have picked up those methods which are most popular. So these are the most popular ones, most popularly used methods of research using a qualitative method, in the qualitative method of research. And what are those methods? First, and there is no hierarchy. It just placed one after another. Don't think that, you know, ethnographic is the best method. That is why it is kept at the top. There is no hierarchy of that kind. These are very small clarification, but I think these are important clarifications. Ethnographic field method of doing research. Then there is something called case study method. There's another method, historiography or oral tradition. There's a very popular method within the qualitative method, content analysis method. Equally popular is focus group method, action research, and archival research. So these are six, seven types of qualitative research which are very popular, which are popularly used by researchers using qualitative methods. Now we will, I will move from one by one explaining what does these methods mean, what are the requirements, what are the what are the limitations, and what are the advantages and what are the limitations. So ethnography. So what is ethnography? Ethnography is the work of describing a culture. So if a researcher aims to study or understand ways of life or culture, it is use, it is a very, very useful tool of research. So if the aim of the researcher is study, is to study culture, life, traditions of, you know, some group of people, this becomes a very useful tool. And how it, and what are the, what is the basic requirement? The researcher spends a relatively very long time with the subject of the study. So where it should be applied, it should be, it is a useful tool for people who want to understand, who want to do research on culture, traditions, ways of life. Second, what is the requirement? What is the basic criteria? What is the basic thing? The basic thing is that the researcher needs to spend a very long period of time in order to collect. First, the researcher needs to collect data himself or herself. The research, the presence of researcher for collecting the data is essential. Second, further point, It is important for the researcher to spend long period of time to collect the data. And where does he or she spend the time? With the subject of research. And who are the people who use ethnography? Mainly used by anthropologists, and they are referred as ethnographers. I am not saying that it should be used only by anthropologists, no. But it is mainly used by anthropologists, because anthropologists normally study culture, ways of life, marriage, tradition, etc., etc. So this is about ethnography. Case study method. Case study method involves systematic gathering of information about a particular person, social setting, event, or a group, which enables the researcher to effectively understand how it operates or functions. Case study method does not always involve individuals. It could be applied to a group or an entire community. So the point I'm trying to emphasize or clarify is, normally if somebody says that I would use a case study method for my research, or I have applied a case study method, or if I say I have applied a case study method for my research, and when I say, you know, I have applied a case study method on, you know, group of farmers who are protesting on Tikri border, but they would say, but you have applied it on a group of individuals. Yes, a case study method can be applied on one person, it could be applied on a group of person, it could even be applied on a geographical locality. So one should not confuse that case study method means the data is being collected only from one person. One person becomes your case. No, a case study method can be applied to one individual, two individual, group of individual, or even a geographical locality. And as I said earlier also, it involves systematic collection of information. Systematic collection of information is involved in any method you apply, and that is related to the basic point which I mentioned earlier, that research is always about systematic collection of data, systematic analysis of the information which has been collected by the researcher. If it is not systematic, if it is haphazard, and that then it's not research. It does not fulfill the criteria of a good research. It should be systematic. It has to be systematic. A method must be involved, whether the data has been collected using a ethnographic method or a case study method. But remember, the point in case study method is that a case study method can be applied to one individual, it could be applied to a group of individuals, it could even be applied to entire community, or it could even be applied to a geographical locality. That becomes your case. And what does the researcher do with that geographical locality, or to the entire community, or to a group of people, or even for one individual? So the researcher collects information systematically using a method, using some method. It has to be done systematically. It cannot be haphazard. This systematic could be, maybe you are recording all the interviews, you are taking notes, you are taking pictures, but it has to be systematic. It is not a data, it could involve various kinds of data gathering method, field study, individual interviews, or even group interviews, as I mentioned earlier. So this is about the case study method. So moving on from case study method to historiography. Historiography is a research method for discovering from records and accounts what happened during the past. So what does the researcher do? Researcher actually collects information. He or she collects information, and historiography is not merely presenting event facts from the past. It is much more than that. It is an attempt to systematically recapture the complex nuances, the people, the meaning, events, and even ideas of the past which shaped the present. The method is usually used for research which aims to uncover the unknown, to seek implications or relationship of events of the past with the present. Normally, this is used by historians. As I said, it is normally this kind of a, in this method, what does the researcher aim to do? The researcher aims to study the past, uncover what has happened in the past. How does someone do that? You have to collect information of what has happened in the past. But how does the research progresses? You have collected the information in the from the past, the researcher is expected to do analysis of the information which has been collected from the past. It is not merely collecting information and presenting that information the way it has been collected. It has to be analyzed. It has to be analyzed properly. You have to give meaning to those events. We can think of various events which has taken place in the history. People have done research on Chauri Chaura. People have done research on 1850. Many people would have done research on 1857 revolt. Many people would have done research on, the tension between or the letters written between Gandhi and Nehru at the time of partition. So if somebody is doing, I'm just giving you some examples, if somebody is doing research on those themes, those titles, those ideas, it is not merely collecting the information from the past and presenting it. So researcher collects those letters, researcher collects those pictures, and then you look at those pictures, you read those letters. So the researcher is expected to come up with nuanced analysis of giving meaning to those events, why it was happening, why certain events may have been significant. So this is another method of doing research, historiography, which is normally used by historians. Content analysis method. As I said, this is a very popular method of doing research. So content analysis method is a technique for making inferences by systematically and objectively identifying special characteristics of messages. Content analysis method could be used for newspaper reports, photographs, videotapes, even the TV or any other item that can be converted into text. So what happens in content analysis? The researcher collects information from whatever is available, from say the newspaper items, photographs, videotapes, and these are relatively of current times. So that the difference between historiography and content analysis, the content analysis normally is done normally done for events which has happened in a relatively recent times. So the researcher collects information through photographs, reports, and then these are converted into text, these are converted into analytical forms. So there are debates whether content analysis leads to quantitative research and qualitative research. This is still unresolved. And why there is a debate? The debate is because somebody is using the newspaper to do content analysis on issues of violence on women. Somebody is doing a research on is there an increase in violence against women in Indian society? Hypothesis, yes, violence against women has increased in Indian society. So that's the question. This is the hypothesis. And as a researcher, I want to do content analysis method. I want to use content analysis method to do my research. So what would the researcher do? Researcher would figure out the sources of information, sources from where he or she is going to do the content analysis. It could be newspaper, it could be project report, it could be photographs, it could be TV, whatever is appearing on the television, etc., etc., on social media. So suppose the newspaper, the researcher thinks of selecting newspaper as the site for collecting information. So the researcher thinks of the newspaper of certain months, certain newspaper, systematically. There has to be a system. It can't be like few days the researcher collects information from this newspaper and some other days he collects information from some other newspaper. So there has to be a systematic selection of newspaper, the timelines, when the which is the time period from which researcher is trying to collect the information. So I'm trying to connect it with why it is, there is a debate about whether it is a quantitative research or a qualitative research. So the researcher selects the newspaper in Hindi, in English, in regional languages, systematic selection of newspaper, systematic selection of the time period. Once that is fixed, then researcher starts collecting the information, and what is called in, they have a systematic method to collect the information about the size, which page. There are different ways: size of the news, which page the news appeared, whether it is from a news agency or whether it is from their own reporter. So the information is collected on different heads, and sometimes the researcher just ends up analyzing what is the size of the information which is reported in the newspaper, what is the size of the information reported in the newspaper on this issue. So if the entire research is presented into the size, then it fits into quantitative research. If researcher says, okay, the full on page one the size was this much centimeter, on page three this was on this much, on edit page this is the space which this theme has occupied. So if the entire data which has been collected by the researcher is presented into numbers, then it becomes quantitative research. But if the entire data which has been collected is actually analyzed, deeper meanings is given to those data, then it becomes a qualitative research. And that is why there is a debate about whether this fits into a quantitative research or it fits into a qualitative research. It depends at what stage the researcher stops. If the researcher has collected the data through content analysis, through newspaper or through TV reports or through various other reports, and then stops, the researcher just presents the finding in terms of numbers, pages, number, size, and then it becomes a quantitative method of research. But if a deeper meaning is attached to those reports, then it becomes a qualitative research. And that is why, as I said, the debate is on. Another unresolved issue regarding content analysis is whether it is a manifest content or it is a latent content. And what is the difference between a manifest content analysis and latent content analysis? Manifest content analysis is limited only to elements which are physically present and countable. So what has been reported? Because sometimes you read the newspaper and then we know, then we say, but I know what has happened there. It is reported like this, but I know the situation in that village. What has happened? There is a story beyond what is being reported in the newspaper. So if the content analysis is limited only to what is physically present and countable, then it is a manifest content analysis. Latent content analysis is extended to an interpretative reading of symbolism underlying the physical data. And if the researcher goes beyond what is there in the data, then it becomes a latent content analysis. Then we move on to another very important or very popular method of research, qualitative method of research, which is focus group method. So what is focus group method? In a focus group method, all the persons from whom the data is to be collected, that becomes the focus group. So the researcher want to collect the data on the topic or collect information on the topic, whichever topic the researcher want to do the research. So those people, it is kind of a group discussion. That is why it is called focus group. So the researcher invites a group of people to have a discussion on the subject or the related subject on which the researcher is doing the research. So all these people are invited in a group setting. There is a discussion, and then whatever is coming out of the discussion becomes the raw material for the researcher. So the researcher notes down those, the whatever is coming out of the discussion, and based on that the researcher does the analysis. It is not as simple as I have stated in few lines, but just to give you some idea about it in slightly details. Focus group interviews are either guided or unguided discussion addressing a particular topic of interest or relevance to the group of the group or the researcher. So normally there are two kinds of focus group interview, focus group. We could call it focus group interviews, we could even call focus group discussions. So the word could be changed interchangeably because these are not one-to-one interviews. It could be guided or unguided. What is a guided? There is a moderator, and the moderator gives time to each and every person, moderates the discussion. So it is a guided discussion. And unguided would be, it's a free-flowing discussion. People are shouting at each other, people are expressing their own opinion. So there is no moderator in that. A typical focus group session consists of small number of participants under the guidance of a facilitator, usually called moderator. Normally there would be a moderator, because if there is no moderator in a focus group discussion, then I don't think the discussion would move in the direction in which the researcher would like the discussion to go. The researcher will not be able to get any substance out of that discussion. And normally the moderator should be the researcher himself or herself. That's the best method. As I said, ethnography has to be done by the researcher. There is no escape. There is no other way. The researcher has to do ethnography. In a focus group discussion, it is desirable that the researcher should be the moderator. But for some reason, if the moderator is not the researcher and somebody else is moderating, even then it should be okay, because the moderator can then report what has come out from the focus group discussion to the researcher. The number of participants in focus group is generally kept small, and there is no prescription. What does small mean? Whether it is 5 people or whether it is 20 people. Small means you have to have an idea about how much time do you have for the discussion. But normally these focus group discussions are not beyond, say, 20-25 people. Ideally it consists of 20 people, 25 people. These focus group discussions are not with 50 or 60 people, not even with 5 or 6 people, doesn't help. So that's an ideal number. The informal setting is preferred to encourage participants to speak freely about behavior, attitude, opinions they possess on a particular issue. So this is the focus group method of doing research, focus group method of data collection. Action research is also referred as participatory action research, because the research is related to action. There is a kind of a follow up. You do research and it is related to some kind of an output, immediate output. It is so defined. Why it is called participatory action research? Because all individuals involved in research, researcher and subjects, are contributing actors in the research. They all participate. This is action research. I want to suppose, now I pick up an example to explain. Is there adequate literacy among women living in Lakhimpur district, in a village in Lakhimpur district in UP? Hypothesis: there is very low level of literacy among women in Lakhimpur district. And if I say, okay, now I want to do action research, so me, my other researcher, we will all go spend time in that village, we will all participate, we'll do research, we will engage with them, so, and we'll try and educate them. So this is kind of an action research, not very popular. It's generally done by people who work in NGO, not by researcher in strict sense, like maybe, I don't know who are the people who have joined this discussion, but this is not the method of research which is adopted by people doing research in the universities for your MPhil PhD degree. This is generally by people who are working in NGOs, and these NGOs want their research is action oriented. They want to demonstrate that their research has an immediate output. So this kind of an action research method is applied by people doing research in NGOs. This research is aimed at integrating the output of research with actual lives of the participant. This is what encourages them to participate actively. Action research is consensual, democratic and participatory. It is mainly done to examine the problem or the issue which affects them or their community. This research also encourages people to plan action after results of the research. So this is action research. And then we move on to the last method within the qualitative method, which is about archival research. As the word suggests, archival research is generally done by people who do research in history, historians. People working in other subjects also can use archival method of doing research, but generally historians spend a lot of time in archives collecting information, collecting their own data. There are two kinds of archive. Generally we classify archives into public archive and private archive. What are public archive? Public archives are, you know, national archives. There are lots and lots of national archives, state level archives. And then there are official documentary records also, even at the district level, even at the village, even in small places. In various districts, there are also district level archives, small ones, but private archives, comprehensive autobiography, topical biography, edited biography. What is the limitation of this? The research is dependent upon available information. Sometimes the researcher is not even aware what information is available and what is not available. So this is kind of a private archive. Somebody is keeping, somebody has a collection of, you know, biographies of someone, autobiographies of someone. This is not in the public domain. So if somebody want to collect this information, it becomes difficult, because then you have to approach people who have, you have to get in touch with those people who are owning these private archives. So these were largely about qualitative method of research. Now I want to move on to the quantitative method of research. As soon as we say quantitative method of research, normally we jump to the conclusion that quantitative method of research means survey. Quantitative method ka matlab hai survey karna hai. No, quantitative method of research can be done. A researcher can use quantitative method of research even without doing a survey. It is not necessary, it is not essential that a researcher using quantitative method for his or her research needs to do a survey. In quantitative method of research, there are two kinds of data which could be used for using a quantitative method: secondary data and primary data. I'm sure most of you would have heard about these two words, secondary data and primary data. So in a quantitative method, researcher could use either secondary data or primary data. Quantitative research using secondary data. And what are those sources? What is a secondary data? A data which is already available from other sources, that is referred as secondary data. And generally, if a data is already available, large set of data is already available, researcher, there is no need to conduct the own survey. Survey is required to be done only if you want to collect your own data, and it becomes necessary if no data is available on the topic on which you want to do research, and you have already stated that you will use a quantitative method, no data is available. So what do you do? Then you have to collect your own data. And how do you collect the data? Then you do the survey. But remember the point what I am trying to mention, or the stress, is that quantitative method of research does not mean that you have to necessarily do a survey. Quantitative method of research can be applied by a researcher even without doing a survey. It is not necessary, it is not essential to do a survey in order to use quantitative method of research. You could use secondary data sources for doing research, and that fits into the criteria of a quantitative research. What are the various sources? Remember, these are not the only sources. I have just flagged off some of the sources from where data can be used by the researcher without doing a survey, without collecting data on his or her own, and it would perfectly fit into the criteria of a quantitative method of doing research. Census of India. There's a lot of data available in Census of India. Census is done every 10 years. 2021 there would be another census. So lots and lots of data available from the Census of India. You could use the data from Census of India to do your own research, and perfect for I am using a quantitative method of research. NFHS data, National Family and Health Survey data. This is also very important data sets, lots and lots of data from NFHS, and there is a report in today's newspaper from NFHS data, and an interesting report. The point I'm trying to say is that lots and lots of data is available from NFHS, and there is an interesting report in today's I just looked at Times of India today morning, just flipped the pages, and the interesting report is I'm sure most of you would know that there is Sharab Bandi in Bihar, which is to say liquor is banned in Bihar. There is no sale of liquor in Bihar. But the highest consumption of liquor has been reported in Bihar based on NFHS survey. And the highest level of liquor consumption among women is reported in, I think, in the state of Sikkim. This is just an example that what all kinds of data is already available. You don't need to collect the data on your own if the data is already available, and it is perfect to say that I am using a quantitative method of research. NSSO, National Sample Survey Organization, lots and lots of data, and these are very large sample size. NSSO data is already also available. Crime Report Bureau, CRB, police records, and there can be several such examples of secondary data sets already available, which can be used by researchers for doing his or her own research using a quantitative method. The point I am trying to mention is that quantitative method requires, it is essential that your data should be in numbers, your data should be in large quantity. But quantitative method does not mean that the researcher must do a survey in order to collect the data. The data is an essential requirement. Data in very large quantity is an essential requirement, but it is not necessary that this data in large quantity must be collected by the researcher himself or herself. If the data is already available on the topic on which, or on the subject on which researcher is doing the research, there is no need for the researcher to do survey to collect data on his or her own. But remember, If the researcher has selected a topic on which there is no data available, then there is no other way than to do a survey, use a survey method for data collection. And how it is done? It is done using a structured questionnaire. So when is survey required? First, it becomes necessary. Survey becomes necessary if the researcher has mentioned that he or she will apply a quantitative method of research, quantitative method of data collection, quantitative method of research. And later on, as he or she progresses in his research topic, he or she realizes, the researcher realizes that on the topic on which he want to do the research, the researcher want to do the research, there is no data available. What does he do? What is the way out? The only way out is, because now at this point you cannot change your research topic, you cannot change your research question, then you have to do, the researcher has to conduct a survey in order to collect the data. But if the data is already available, it is not necessary. So it becomes necessary for the researcher to do survey only if the data is not available on the topic on which the researcher is doing the research, and he or she has already stated in the research proposal that the researcher would be using a quantitative method. The second scenario could be, the data is available, the researcher wants to substantiate some more data. So from where does the researcher substantiate the data? New data needs to be collected, for which the researcher will have to do survey. There could be another scenario. There is no data available on the topic on which the researcher wants to do the study. And in that case, the researcher has to do a survey. There is no other way. There is no escape from doing survey in order to collect data to fit the criteria of a quantitative research. Now, what is the basic difference between a quantitative and a qualitative research? And this is where I would stop, and then you can ask questions. The basic difference, qualitative method of research and quantitative method of research. Qualitative method of research, the data is, size of the data is small, often very small, point of from where the data is collected, but collection of in-depth information. Quantitative research method, data, whether it is primary or secondary, and I did spend some time explaining primary and secondary data, whether it is a secondary data like NSSO, NFHS or census, the data must be of large size. And this is what is sample size. Sample size must be large. In qualitative method of research, it is not about size. It can be from one person. Remember the case study method. I did mention case study method. It could be just one person. It could be just one village. So in a qualitative method of research, that's the basic difference. There are various other differences between a qualitative method and quantitative method. But the basic difference between a qualitative method of research and quantitative method. In a quantitative method of research, the data is in numerical form. It can be either primary or secondary data, but the sample size must be large. The quantity of data must be large. In qualitative research, the data, it is not about number, it is about the quality, in-depth information. Nobody asks a question whether the ethnography, we all know that ethnography is not done in 10 villages or 20 villages or 100 villages. Ethnographers spend a lot of time in just one village, two villages. Case study is done on few cases, but in quantitative method, survey is not about collecting data from 5 people, 10 people. It is about large number. Whether it is a data which is collected through survey or it is a data which is which is being used by the researcher from a secondary sources. And I gave the example of secondary sources, which are, say, census, NSSO, NFHS, etc., etc. The data must be of large quantity. So these two words are self-explanatory: qualitative research, quantitative research. In a quantitative research, the data must be of large quantity. In a qualitative research, it's not about quantity, it is about quality. But don't think that the data quality in quantitative research is poor. It is mentioned qualitative research because the probing is very deep. There are follow-up questions. The thick descriptions come out from a qualitative research. Thick descriptions doesn't come out from a quantitative method of research. So I'm looking at the watch. It is 12:30 now. As I said, how to decide which method to select for conducting research. This is the lecture which will take place tomorrow at 11. But we still have 10-15 minutes. If participants want to ask questions, you are most welcome to ask questions. And I will try and look at the chat box to figure out some questions. I'm not sure whether I would be able to answer all the questions, but I will still try. Thank you very much.